you doing today? Hey, listen, today is a special day because it's Palm Sunday. So we thought the only way to celebrate was to have a beautiful choir up here with us. It's gonna be amazing. Listen, we read about Palm Sunday in Matthew 21 when Jesus mounted the donkey and rode into town, and it says, the people put their cloaks and prayer garments down on the road, and others cut down branches from the trees and threw them down as a welcome mat for him. Jesus rode into the center of the procession, crowds going before him and crowds coming behind him, calling out, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven. So listen, can we welcome the King into this place today? Can we just begin to lift up a sound of worship for Jesus? We welcome you, oh Jesus. We welcome you today. Oh, we welcome you today. Let's sing, choir.
Together worthy, who we talking about? He's my shepherd, my protector. That's my king, that's my rock, that's my anchor, my defense.
We'll be right back.
Just tell him how he's worthy. Worthy is the Lamb.
Thank you. is coming in. We invite you here today. Make way for the King is coming. Make way for the King is coming in. Oh, the King is coming. Make way for the King is coming. Make way for the King is coming in.
Jesus was riding in to town on a donkey, on a prophecy that was fulfilled 500 something years early. They said, your king will come into town on a donkey. And everybody's, make way, the king is coming. Make way, the king is coming. And they began to lay down the palm branches, believing that victory is coming. And I believe that Jesus, even though it wasn't the physical victory that day, he had victory in hell. When he beat up the devil, right? He stole the keys of hell, of death and the grave. We have victory. And it all started this week on Palm Sunday when Jesus rode into town. So, Father, we make room for you today. We make way for you today. God, begin to prepare our hearts this Easter season today. Father, we open our hearts to hear what you have for us today. God, we make room for you. We make way for you. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Come on, Covenant, let's give him a shout of praise today. Man, what a powerful worship time. I want to go back into that song, but I don't think we have time right now. But that was powerful. Happy Palm Sunday to you. Everybody looks beautiful. You got your Easter colors coming out already. We're excited that you're here in the room today. Make sure you greet someone. Give them a high five. Give them a hug. Tell them they're looking beautiful and handsome today. And if you're joining us online, we just want to say welcome. We believe that God is going to speak to you today. Hop in the chat and let us know where you're joining from.
Easter at Covenant is just around the corner. Make plans to join us and invite family, friends, and neighbors to commemorate the greatest event in history, the resurrection of our Savior. In addition to our normal service times, we've added a traditional sunrise service at 7:30 a.m. For more information about all of our Holy Week events, check out the Cove Live app.
Good Friday is March 29th. Join us for a family service where we will worship, share Holy Communion, and remember Jesus' sacrifice on the cross. Service starts at 7 p.m. at our North and South campuses.
Water Baptism Sunday is coming. If you recently dedicated your life to Jesus, water baptism is your next step. Baptism represents the burial of the old way of life and being raised to new life in Christ. If you would like to be water baptized, you can register on the Cove Live app and be sure to invite your friends and family to celebrate with you.
I have a simple question for you today. Who do you trust when it comes to your finances, your ability, your career, your boss? Or do you trust God and His plan for your finances? Certainly, we have a responsibility to work hard, improve ourselves for a better opportunity, and to steward what God places in our hands. However, your source is not your job or your boss. They are just the vehicles that God opened up for you to earn a living. Here's what Psalms 118:8 instructs us to do. It is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. Although man may have a will to help, oftentimes may not have it in his power to do so. And when it is in his power and has promised it, too many times, man being infallible disappoints and/or is unfaithful to his promise. But the good news is we serve an infallible God. He is able and willing to bless the work of your hand. He is faithful to His word, and He will never leave you nor forsake you. And He is unchangeable in His promises. There was a time in my life when I was starting a new self-employed career, so obviously finances were tight, but I continued to make God's house first and continued to tithe. With God as my witness, we never missed a meal, never missed paying a bill, and even received funds from unknown and unusual sources that got us through. As David said in Psalms 37:25, I was young and now I'm old, yet I have never seen the righteous forsaken or their children begging for bread. Bottom line, it is good to trust in the Lord. Those who do enjoy peace, live in safety, and will not want for any good thing. That's His promise to you. Your true source for all is God. His plan is simple. Bring the tithe into the storehouse. Then you will be a good steward of the 90%, and you will surely see the hand of God in your life. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your promise that you will never leave us or forsake us. We trust in your plan for our life and our finances because you are a faithful God. As we choose to put your house first, we know you will bless our house. In the name of Jesus, amen. As you give today, there are several options for you to do so. You can scan the QR code, go to our Cove Live app, give online or in person in our boxes in the lobby. On behalf of all the lives changed weekly, thank you for your giving.
What's up, Cove? Hey, I'm so glad you decided to be in church on Palm Sunday. My name is Ryan. If we haven't had a chance to meet, welcome to Covenant Church. I want you to know you are in a house of faith. I don't know what your journey's been,
I don't know what you have been asking God for a long time, but I believe today could be your day. I believe that in the house of faith, anything can happen. And perhaps you walked in today and your face on low, my face on high. And perhaps the person on your right and the person on your left has some faith for you as well. It's the power of us coming together. In fact, I want you to look at the person on your right, look at the person on your left and say, I got you today. I got you today. I got you today. Spoiler alert, I'm going to just tell you how we're going to end the service. We're going to end the service today praying for miracles. How about that? Okay? So go ahead and get your faith up right now. Because I believe God is on the move. And what we celebrate this week has ushered in something so powerful for the whole world. Heaven on earth as it is in heaven. I'm not trying to wait to heaven to see his glory. I believe anything can happen today. All across the world today, people who are followers of Jesus are celebrating what we call Palm Sunday to commemorate the significance of Jesus' entering into Jerusalem just a few days before he would be crucified. I think entrances are important. How a person comes in the room, I believe that it matters. I don't know if anybody's ever just showed up at your house and how they came in, they brought a certain energy that could be good, could be bad. I go to the gym a lot. I always marvel at how people enter into the gym, you know, because there are some people, they got that pre-workout thing going on and they just come in extra energy. Bright yellow, you know, like there are some people that go to the gym to work out. Then there's everybody else. They go to the gym to be seen. You know what I mean? Like the way they come in, I see more cameras out at the gym than ever before. Everybody's an influencer, okay? Everybody got the tripod set up. I'm like, I didn't know Lifetime Fitness even lets you do this, okay? But they posing to be chosen. You know what I'm saying? Like, they just got their outfit on. They ain't even sweating. You know what I mean? It's like, but they have entered into the gym for a different reason. Maybe there's somebody here today. Maybe some of us came to praise the Lord. Others may have entered the premises scoping and hoping. You know what I mean? Like, that's my king. Hey, what's up, girl? I see you. Like, man, where you get that outfit from, man? That's a club outfit, man. That ain't no church outfit. You know what I mean? In the moments that we have today, I'd love to draw our attention to how Jesus entered Jerusalem. There's more there than I think we could ever know. I want to give us some historical context, perhaps some color to help us truly ascertain the significance of this moment in Jesus' life and what on earth it means for you and for me. If you can, go to Luke 19. We're going to start at verse 28. It says, when he had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. And it came to pass when he drew near to Bethphage, in Bethany, at the mountain called Olivet, that he sent two of his disciples, saying, go into the village opposite you, whereas you enter, you will find a colt tied, on which no one has ever sat. Loose it and bring it here. And if anyone asks you, why are you loosing it? Thus you shall say to him, because the Lord has need of it. So those who were sent went their way and found it just as he had said to them. But as they were loosing the colt, the owners of it said to them, why are you loosing the colt? And they said, the Lord has need of him. Then they brought him to Jesus. Interesting note here. We don't know which two disciples Jesus sent, but in my mind, they did rock, paper, scissors, okay, like to figure out who's going to be the two, because this has got to be a scary mission, okay? Just imagine this is in Texas for just a moment, okay? Like, I got to come to your house and say, hey, I need to grab your car and then you're going to get shot in Texas messing around, okay? Like you cannot just walk up to somebody else's property and maybe he sent two just in case one of them gets capped, you know what I mean? Like, they need backup. Like, I need two of y'all to go get his back, okay, in case there's trouble. But his instructions were interesting to me. Go, you'll find a colt. Hey, I've already gone before you. I know what's there, but more importantly, I know who's there. It's somebody there that I can trust. And what I marvel at is the unknown and unnamed colt owner. Jesus says, if there's any trouble, here's the secret password. The Lord has need of it. Because you see how he came out extra energy. You know what I'm saying? Hey, man, what you grabbing my stuff for, man? Chill. The Lord has need of it. All right, go on, watch your business. Go ahead. Got no problem here. We don't know anything about this colt owner except he was getting something ready for his Lord. Because that's interesting. The secret password is the Lord has need of it. I found it interesting, especially around this particular holiday season. It's easy for Jesus to be Savior. Because you need rescue. Yeah, I need some help. And there's a Savior offering to help you. Yeah, of course, we'll take that. But he needs to be Lord, which means he's in charge. Whoa. I don't know about that. Perhaps he's Savior in your life, but he's yet to be Lord. You can come to church and still not give him the keys. You can worship and still not let him be in the driver's seat. This guy, who we don't know. We don't know anything about him except he's got something ready for his Lord. And he is so Lord of his life that the Lord can count on him to say, hey, this is the secret password. The Lord has need of it. What we know about this guy's life is that Jesus is Lord. And when Jesus is Lord, Jesus can count on you to be where you need to be, when you need to be there, to be a blessing to somebody else. I don't know about you, but I want to be a cult owner kind of Christian. Because you can need a blessing or be a blessing. And when you're trying to be a blessing, you pray different. And I'm trying to shift somebody's mindset today that maybe has been in a position their whole life of going, somebody please bless me. But today you might make the shift to go, no, I'm going to be the kind of cult owner. Like, Lord, whatever you have need of in my life, whether regardless of the amount of resources I have, if the Lord has need of it, I'm trying to be a blessing to somebody else. You can wake up every day going, Lord, bless me. Or you can wake up every day and go, Lord, put somebody in my path who needs you, that has what you've already given me. Here's how the story continues. Luke 19, verse 36 says, and they threw their own clothes on the colt, and they set Jesus on him. And as he went, many spread their clothes on the road. Then, as he was now drawing near the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works they had seen. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Now, I want to give you some historical context that you won't necessarily find in Scripture, but you will find this in Jewish history and you will find this in Roman history. And so, first you must understand who Herod the Great was. Herod the Great really ruled this region. He had some very strategic relationships with the Roman government. He was extremely wealthy. He was a brilliant architect. He was the Steve Jobs of his day when it comes to innovation in architecture. And so he was really able to keep this region stable. He was a genius at it. Now, when he died, he actually split the region up into three parts. Up in the north, you had Philippi, and that's what he gave to his son, Philippi. And then there was one in the in just beneath. I think we have a, do we have a map somewhere? Where's the map? Where's my map? Where's it? There it is. Okay, great. So here it is. This is Herod the Great's kingdom. And as you can see here, you've got Decapolis, you've got Galilee, you've got Samaria. And then let's go to the next map. Where are we at? Let's see what the next one is. All right. So you can see Archelaus is his other son that has this whole white region. Philippi has that orange region up there. And then Decapolis and Perea, Galilee there, you can see that was Herod Antipas. So anytime you see any one of those names that Jesus is navigating in the Gospels, I want you to be able to understand the back of your Bible a little bit. Okay, those maps. Okay, there's a reason for that. Now, Archelaus, this little white region here, he wasn't a very good leader. In fact, he lost the region within the first 2 years of his daddy giving it to him. And the Roman government, Tiberius, he says, man, we got to get this region under control. And so he sent in what historians call Rome's bulldog. His name is Pontius Pilate. So they send Pontius Pilate in to say, hey, can you get this region under control? Now, here's what's beautiful about this whole thing is Herod the Great was so great at building architecture. He built multiple homes all across this region. And there's one in Caesarea Maritima. I believe we've got a photo of that as well. So you can see Herod the Great, he builds all that. Even to this day, they can't figure out how he got underwater concrete. To this day, they're still trying to figure out, like, how did this guy do this? And so he built a home for the emperor to say, hey, anytime you come to this region, you can stay at my house. And so this is where Pontius Pilate would stay to keep the region under control. So Herod, he also built for Caesar a whole city to honor Caesar. And then what you have is he built another home in Jerusalem where any Roman governor or government official, anytime they came to Jerusalem, they didn't want to stay in anything Jewish. So they said, hey, we've got just this house just for you. So, long story short, Herod the Great got a couple Airbnbs for Pontius Pilate, okay? And he could kind of pick which crib he wanted to stay at, when he wanted to stay at, okay? Now, here is the significance of this. So, Pontius Pilate would stay in Caesarea Maritima, this marina area, this harbor area. And what he would do is during Passover, he would come down to Passover. Now, what you must understand about Passover is the time, it's a Jewish celebration for them to remember what? The Exodus. Hey, y'all remember that one time we left that vitriolic, you know, governor? We just dipped on him? We should do that again. And so what Rome decided, they said, we want to keep our soldiers nearby just in case they start drinking a little bit too much wine and get a little crazy on us. So what most people don't understand about what Jesus is doing is he is entering into Jerusalem. Some historians say, within at least 3 days of the same time that Pontius Pilate would have entered the city as well. And I want to compare and contrast how both of them entered. This is the path that Pontius Pilate would have taken. He would have taken his oceanside view. He would have come with soldiers riding on a stallion to say, I'm in charge and don't get any crazy ideas. And he's coming from the west. Here is Jesus's path. He's coming from the Mount of Olives, and he's coming from the east, signifying a prophecy that the Messiah would come from the east. Pontius Pilate is entering into the city. Some believe it happened at the exact same time. I wasn't there. I don't know. But you've got this army and power coming into the city to say, y'all, be easy. Don't get crazy. And then you've got Jesus entering in from the east with a few teenage fishermen, one zealot ex-gang member, and a homie who used to work for the IRS. Just think about this for a second. ragtag group. You know what I mean? Like I'm just comparing. Like most of us never really see this, but that's the tension in this entrance. Because everybody's looking west at one point, they're like, oh, here come Pontius Pilate. And donkey? And these kids, you got a youth group coming in? Like, what are we? Donkeys had a significant meaning in scripture. In fact, emissaries would often send donkeys overloaded with gifts to appease the wrath of an enemy, preventing bloodshed. Jacob sent donkeys packed with treasures to avoid the wrath of his brother Esau. See Genesis 32 and 33. In 1 Samuel, we see Abigail take 200 loaves of bread, 2 skins of wine, 100 cakes of raisins, and 200 cakes of pressed figs, and wilderness provision for David and his men, and loaded them on donkeys for David to spare her family. On Palm Sunday, Jesus is the gift that would prevent bloodshed for you and for me. Now, there are some critics of Jesus who would say he knew the scriptures well, that he knew the prophecies well, and so therefore he lived his life trying to fulfill messianic prophecies and sort of manufacture lordship, which, okay, let's just go there for a minute. This moment would be one of those moments because Jesus and everyone in this context knew the Zechariah prophecy very, very well. Zechariah 9, it says, rejoice greatly, daughter Zion. Shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. We see Pontius Pilate coming in with his crew. And then they look left and go, wait a second. We know this prophecy. Some would say, yeah, Jesus chose the donkey on purpose to fulfill this messianic prophecy. But let's just think about this logically for just a second, okay? To choose this one on purpose as a perfect man is suicide. Like, even if you could, you wouldn't, because none of us choose to die. None of us, not just choose to die, choose to be crucified. In fact, it's interesting. One of the things that I looked up in history, I was curious if there were any other people in recent history that thought they were the Messiah. And I'm just curious what happened to those people. In fact, in the mid-1600s, there was a guy who actually got a pretty large following that some believed was the Messiah, okay? His name was Sabbatai Zvi, okay? He was a rabbi who proclaimed himself to be the Messiah in 1666, okay? And he got widespread, and I say he went viral. There was no social media in the 1600s, so give me a break for a second, okay? But there was a lot of swirling going around in the Jewish community of like, I think this is the guy. But watch this. He got arrested by Ottoman authorities, and in that moment, he converted to Islam to avoid execution. And we laugh, but you would do the same thing. Because everybody wants to be Lord. Wow, yeah, look at the perks. Until you gotta die. So even if he did, you wouldn't choose it, and nobody else would. Oh, and by the way, everyone that has claimed to be Messiah, we can find their bones. They have a gravesite, not ours. The tomb is empty. And oh, by the way, they've been looking for 2,000 years. Jesus chose death. He got on that donkey knowing what it would mean for you and for me. And this donkey move is one of the first moves that is going to get a perfect man crucified. Because you can see it upset the established order. In verse 39,
Oh, I love this. And some of the Pharisees called to him from the crowd, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." They're already upset. They know the donkey move. They're like, "Who do you think you rebuke your disciples for worshiping you right now?" And then Jesus, with his iconic line, but he answered them and said to them, "I tell you that if these should keep silent, the stones would immediately cry out." I would if I could, but you know, I just they gonna worship me no matter what. And if I shut them up, guess what? The rocks will begin to rumble. And if you tried to push down the rocks, then the ocean would begin to cry out. All creation cries out to its Savior in the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings. He's like, so it would be a waste of my time. I kind of wish he had done it, though, because that would just have been awesome. You know what I mean? You imagine he silences his disciples. And all of a sudden, the rocks begin to go, "Hosanna, Hosanna." Can you imagine the rocks begin to cry out, "Make way for the King to come"? Like, there is nothing that you're going to do. And this is what I tell people, because some people, they don't like worship. They don't like to sing. I just go, listen, if you don't like it now, you're going to hate heaven, because that's all I'm going to be doing. I can't wait. Ooh, I can't wait. And I'm not waiting to go, because I can do that right now, right? Like, but some people are like, "I don't really like that song." I'm like, you are going to bow sooner or later. You might as well start now. Your lips will cry out one way or another. And I just have a feeling that when we see him face to face, we're going to wish that we had done it a little bit more. The donkey move upset religious leaders. But the second move after he got off the donkey was the straw that broke the camel's back. Matthew 21:12. Then, they're already mad. They're about to be madder. Then Jesus went into the temple of God and drove out all those who bought and sold in the temple and overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. And he said to them, "It is written, my house shall be called a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of thieves." Historical context here that we may not always get to see in the scripture. There was corruption inside the religious leadership. And here's how it worked. The context here is that they have turned a holy place into a market on the Temple Mount. Now, on this Temple Mount was a whole section. Okay, there was a whole section designed for the Gentile, the outsider. I mean, we're talking about a group of people that were literally on the outside looking in. They were not allowed to go into the courts of the temple, because that's what the law was. They can only get close to the temple, look at God, gaze on God, worship God, if you will, but from a distance. Sometimes we've got so many people here that we have overflow. Okay, imagine having overflow on purpose, okay? And like there's some empty seats here today. Imagine me saying to you, "Hey, sorry, you can't come in here. We're going to need you to come over and overflow, okay? That's where you're going to watch the service. You can raise a hand, but don't get too crazy." Like, that's... Think of us, a whole section for the outsider. That's how the Levitical system was set up. This space is reserved for them. That's their space. And what the priesthood had done, what the chief priest had done, is they had turned that space into a marketplace, a place of worship designated for the outsider. They had turned into a market for convenience. In my studies, I learned about what's called the booths of Annas. And the booth, it's
It's the Hebrew way you say Annas. It's the same Annas that you find in the gospel accounts in Jesus' trial, A-N-N-A-S. And his booths were run by the priesthood. So when you came to the temple, every single year you had Roman money. But you weren't allowed to take that Roman money onto the Temple Mount. So you had to go and exchange it. And so you had to use the proper currency so you weren't committing idolatry when you gave your tithe and your offerings. Imagine if we did that today. Okay, we say, we're going to need crypto today. Okay, we're going to have to transfer that. Like that was the situation. They also needed sacrifices. And these sacrifices needed to be approved sacrifices. So the priest said, don't worry. We'll sell you sacrifices here on site. And then that way we can make it easy for you. They'll already be approved sacrifices. You see how that works? So guess who sold the sacrifices? The priest. Guess who decided whether or not the sacrifice was okay? The priest. Guess who set the price on those sacrifices? The priest. Guess who raised the sacrifices? The priest. It would seem like this was a system that is ripe for a little bit of corruption. And they've planted it smack dab in the middle of the place that is designated for the worship for the outsiders. Here's Jesus getting off of his donkey. And Jesus is going, people were supposed to come into my Father's house and connect with their father. But now you've turned it into something else. This is supposed to be a place of hope. It's supposed to be a place for the down and out. This is supposed to be a place for somebody that feels like they didn't get it right the first time. And for those that feel like they're literally on the outside looking in. And now you've turned it into something it was never supposed to be. Perhaps we are all familiar with Jesus turning over tables. It's, in some of our minds, the most un-Jesus thing Jesus ever did. Because you're like, man, flipping table, Jesus? We have this Jesus in our mind of children sitting on the lap and healing people and opening blind eyes and this very kind Jesus. So to see this Jesus, it feels very un-Jesus in how Jesus has been marketed. So perhaps you've heard this story before, Jesus snapping, Jesus flipping tables. But what I believe is often untold is the verse right after the story. Yeah, Jesus snapped. Yes, Jesus cleared the tables. But here's the verse that just blesses me today. This is the verse that is my Palm Sunday verse. Then the blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he healed them. A den of thieves got turned into a house of miracles. For who? We're not talking about a Jesus that's just mad. We're talking about a Jesus who's trying to make way for people to get to their Father and to receive miracles, which is a very Jesus thing to do. He said, let me get the house back to its original intention. Let me clear out this stuff. When he cleared it out, who came? The blind, the lame. The blind and lame were the most outcast in society. And here they come. Because Jesus made space for them. The Gentiles, the outsider, the outcast, the turned away, the disappointed, the discouraged. That's who Jesus paved the way for. And I just hope on Palm Sunday, when you see branches and palm branches waved in the air, may you and I remember that a Savior cleared a path for us to experience Him in a powerful and fresh way. I don't know what your story is today. I don't know what your spiritual journey has been thus far. But I believe God has ordered our steps to be in the room together for this particular Sunday. You did not just check a box today. So yeah, we probably should go to church, that Easter thing. All right, come on, let's get dressed. No. God's been trying to get a hold of you a long time. So yes, I believe today is Miracle Sunday. I believe Palm Sunday represents a man thousands of years ago getting on a donkey to say, yeah, I'm him. I'm the guy that, yes, is making a decision. Yeah, I know the prophecy well, but I'm choosing it anyways. Because I can, what we couldn't see at the beginning of the ride, was the blind and the lame that needed him to get on that donkey to ride all the way to a temple to clear the path for them. So in these next few moments, we're going to sing some more. And we've got an amazing prayer team down here that today, if you need a miracle, today's your Sunday. Today's Miracle Sunday. Perhaps for you today, the biggest miracle for you could be forgiving somebody and letting it go, because maybe you haven't been able to for a very, very long time. If you're here today and you need a miracle, it's why we came to church. We didn't come to play church. We didn't come to just sing songs. We came to lift up a name above all names that we believe has healing power in His hands. There's nothing special about us. There's something special about Him that desperately wants you to experience Him in a powerful way. Go ahead and stand on your feet. A worship team is making their way out. I believe in these next few moments, scoliosis is going to be healed in Jesus' name. I believe in these next few moments, mental health has to bow at the name of Jesus. I believe in these next few moments, cancer has to disappear. I believe in these next few moments, marriages are going to begin to turn around. Don't be embarrassed to come down as a couple and say, will you pray for us? Where else are you going to go all week long? Where people can join you in faith and believe that anything is possible. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come to you. I pray for each and every family, each and every person watching online. God, I pray that on Miracle Sunday, people would begin to receive miracles. God, we got our faith up, and we trust that you are the same God in the scriptures that you are here today. We lift you up, and we ask that you would have your way in our lives, have your way in our souls, have your way in our bodies. Do what only you can do, Holy Spirit. Have your way in this place. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Everybody said, amen. Our prayer teams are coming down here, and we would love to pray for you in these next few moments.
This is a house of worship. This is a place of praise. Where every demon trembles. Thank you.
this room. We're going to sing a song. We're singing Same God. We're going Same God. Is that what we're going? We're going Same God in a little bit. But I wanted some friends of mine to come up and actually share a miracle. Just in case you think we'd just be making stuff up. That's not what we do. We truly believe in the miraculous healing power of Jesus. And these are two friends of mine. How long have you guys been coming to Covenant Church? You can put the mic up.
Since
2005. And they have served faithfully for almost two decades. We're about to have your 20th year anniversary. We should throw y'all a party or something like that. That'd be great. Will you tell the church briefly what the past couple of years have been like for you and what the Lord has truly done in your life?
Absolutely. God is good all the time. Mm-hmm. I had a health scare last year, and I think it was just, I'm like, I had a nervous breakdown. But they don't call it that anymore because doctors can't code for that. But I just was overwhelmed, had too many balls in the air. And he had been telling me to slow down. Don't serve on that board, you know, get off of that one. And then we were selling our house at Robeson Ranch, and it was just overwhelming. And so all of a sudden, it's like he had to rush me to the hospital five different times for high blood pressure. What was it, like 199 over?
Well, it was a Saturday morning, and she was basically catatonic.
Yeah.
I didn't know what to do. I just took her.
Yeah. He took me to the hospital like five different times in one day. Yeah. And they had me on like seven different medications. Now, that'll make you crazy right there. But God is faithful. So this happened, and then from there, because he had to work every day, he had to find a place for me where I could get 24-hour service and or supervision and medication management. So he put me in the behavioral center. Now, that's a psych ward, but I'm not crazy. But they could check on you every 15 minutes while you're sleeping, you know, waking you up in the morning. But anyways, I was there two different times for 10 days at a time. But you can't have your Bible. You can't have, phone numbers. I don't know that our kid's phone, our daughter's phone number or his without, just hitting an automatic dial on my cell phone. And so let me tell you, it's important to meditate on the Word of God because you don't know when they're going to take your Bibles away from you.
100%.
And it was like being in jail, okay? But, as soon as they closed the door, I'm like, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And all of the scriptures I've been meditating on for years, that would just come to me, God, you promised me sweet sleep, so I'm going to sleep, And so from there, I had to go to a rehab hospital because all of a sudden my right foot, I couldn't lift my right foot. JR said they called it ataxia, a right foot drop. And a lot of people have that, and they never recover from it. So I went to rehab for that. It didn't work. From there, I went to assisted living in Frisco for 8 months. And, I was there 8 months. But what happened was so amazing. I don't know how many months it was before this happened or how many weeks. But one day, I got to the dining hall, and the attendant said, Miss Bobby, you left your walker in the room. And I looked down. I'm like, I sure did. And I said, praise the Lord. Woo, glory be to God. I said, I have a miracle. That happened to me. I mean, I would always hear people's testimony, and I would go, oh, my God, what's our testimony? Oh, we had the money to pay the full tuition, K-12, and grad school and college. And so that was always my testimony. God is faithful. But I said, now I have a real testimony because God healed me and I got to see it. Praise the Lord. I've got to tell you this too.
I remember when my wife and I came to visit you. I don't even know if you remember saying this.
Okay.
But at one point, I believe this was in the psych ward-ish kind of place that we were at. And you said to me and my wife, this is where it ends for me. I will always be here. And I remember my wife and I looked at you and said, no, you won't always be here. But I remember, because they sit in the same spot every Sunday, so whenever I'm praying, I know where you sit, okay? And everybody, don't nobody move. Y'all should switch it up every now and then. But I remember being sad not seeing you in your spot. And I'll never forget the first Sunday I saw them back in their spot. And I just thought, walking miracle. I don't know if you remember that, but I remember that, and it meant something to me to see you worship God in your spot. Okay, you know what I'm saying? And so, all right, so what's the last miracle? What is it?
I've got to tell you this. Every day I would eat with different women and everything, but one lady was really sweet. When I first met her, she said, how old am I? And I said, well, I don't know. When is your birthday? And she said, well, it's in October. And no, she said, I said, how old are you? And she said, I think I'm 89. And I said, well, when is your birthday? And she told me, I said, well, you won't be 89 until October. And she said, okay, great. So we really hit it off. And she was just so sweet. We would talk, and she'd talk about how good she's been in life. She raised her husband's kids and helped her parents and did all this, and she knew she was going to heaven. And so after I let her talk about all that, I said, well, bless your heart. God has really been good to you, and you've taken care of everyone. And I know God's going to take care of you. And then I said, but that's not how you get to heaven. It's not based on how good you are.
Come on.
It's based on how good God is.
Yeah.
And if you want to make sure you're going to heaven, I can lead you to the Lord. And she said, okay. I had just gotten my phone back. I didn't even have my phone for maybe over a year. And I looked up a salvation prayer, and we read it together. She accepted the Lord.
Let's go.
And then I ran to my room real quick, because he had brought me a 21-day devotional that Robert Morris's church left at our complex where we live. And it wasn't for me, because two people from the church had already given me devotionals. But I kept it. And sure enough, I went to the room, found it, put the date to her from me, went back out there. And I said, now that you're a Christian, here's something you can read for the next 21 days. And she said, okay. And sure enough, 2 days later or so, she's out there in the area reading through there. And I just said, God is faithful. Absolutely.
Yeah, I you got something, Jay? Yeah, Jay, sure, go ahead.
To show that this is the house of miracles, she had follow-up appointments with her neurology office. And when the neurologist who saw her originally, he came to me after her first visit and said, Doc, what I see, if she needs a spinal tap right now, and if I find what I think I'm going to find, you'll be planning her funeral in 6 months. First visit, he said that. Now, when we went back...
Well, let me tell you what happened. I'm like, hold on a second now. When I heard that, it's like God quickened my spirit, and I said, I shall not die and live and declare the works of the Lord.
Woo! In Jesus' name.
But to make it shorter, I hate we're going long, but the neurologist who had seen her originally, and all of this time had passed, we go back for a follow-up, and she walks into the office, and she throws her head, my miracle! That's the neurologist saying that. She says, no foot drop, no walker, no splints. No, a medication had been dropped. She was on 9 medications, all right? I mean, I couldn't spell some of these medications myself. So basically, she's a miracle. Well, the neurologist attends our McKinney campus. We didn't know that. Right.
Come on, can we lift up the name of Jesus one more time? The King is among us. You're in the house of miracles. We're going to continue singing. We'll continue praying for you. I just want you to know that there are people that are walking, talking miracles in the room.
And I believe the same God of the Bible is the same God that is with us right now. And so as you continue to worship, you might need to come down for somebody you're praying for. You might need to text somebody and say, hey, church going long today, what you need, okay? Like, whatever it is, we're here for you. So as the worship team continues to sing, Lord, we lift you up once again. We thank you for the miracles that are happening right now. And I pray, God, that we would continue to see many more today. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Bow and every eye closed. If you're here today and you want to receive the greatest miracle ever, which is surrendering your life to Jesus. We ran long today on purpose for you. That's why we came. Because we know people are coming to the door. We know people are watching online that need a Savior. So we would be remiss if we didn't take a moment to give you an opportunity to perhaps rededicate your life to Christ. Today, if that's you with every head bowed and every eye closed, if you say, hey, Ryan, I'd love to surrender my life to Christ, would you just slip up your hand and say, hey, Ryan, that's me. Ryan, that's me. I see your hand. I see your hand. I see your hand. That's great. I see four hands, five, six, seven. Anybody else? Anybody else? Eight. That's awesome. Anybody else? Nine, 10. 11, we'll wait for you. 12, 13, anybody else? Anybody else? 14, that's awesome. Anybody else? Anybody else? 15, 16, anyone else? 17, that's awesome. That's awesome. Hey, can we all pray this prayer together? Say, Jesus, thank you for dying on a cross for my sins. I ask now that you would be the Lord and Savior of my life. I surrender my past, my present, and my future to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Everybody said, amen. Come on, can we thank God for all 17 people that gave their heart to Christ? It is literally the best decision you've ever made in your life if you prayed that prayer today. Oh, we want you to scan this QR code on the screen, or you can text the word SAVE to 54636. What we want to do is we want to send you a 7-day booklet that can kind of walk you through what your life looks like now as a believer. And also today, I want you to be on the hunt for miracles in your life. And if God has done a miracle in your life, would you let us know? Would you email us? Will you go to the Contact Us page on the app, on the website? Because we want to encourage other people with what God has done in your life. Once again, can we make some noise for each and every person that gave their heart to Christ? We've got a fun weekend coming up at both locations. Don't forget to join us on Good Friday and Easter. And I pray that God continues to do miracles in your life. We had Testimony Sunday. You ain't testified in a while. You know, I like it. I like it. Can I bless you before we go? May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. And may he cover you with his precious name. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Have a great week.